I think I'll get started. Good evening, and thanks for joining us, everybody. And I think this is going to be a very interesting event. My name is Susan Hay, and I am president of Environment Haliburton, one of the three organizations who are sponsoring this event tonight. The other two organizations are Seniors for Climate Action Now, or SCAN, and Climate Action Muskoka, or CAM. We have had a great response for this event tonight, so that shows interest in the subject of whether we can solve the climate crisis with renewables. I'd like to ask you to stay muted, as any noise from participants can distract from the presentation. Also, we would ask that you only use the chat function for questions of the speaker once the presentation begins. This event is being recorded and will be posted on the Environment Haliburton and SCAN websites, and a link to the YouTube video will be available on the CAM website once it's edited. I would now like to introduce John Hewitt, who is the co-chair of SCAN's Indigenous Solidarity Committee, who will give our land acknowledgement. Over to you, John.
Thank you, Susan. I live in what is called in the Mohawk language, Tsi Takaranto. Indigenous peoples have inhabited this land for at least 11,000 years. The Indigenous peoples who inhabited this land were the Huron-Wendat, Anishinaabeg, Haudenosaunee, and most recently, the Mississaugas of the Credit River, with whom we settlers have a treaty relationship. Today, members of many First Nations, Métis, and Inuit peoples from all over Turtle Island live on this land. We acknowledge that we and our governments are settlers who occupy, govern, and benefit from the wealth of this land we call Canada, from which Indigenous peoples were dispossessed and continue to be materially impoverished through colonialism. This land dispossession and material impoverishment continues in lands where settler governments and companies promote mining and logging on Indigenous territory without the free, prior, and informed consent of Indigenous peoples. The background you see behind me shows the breathing lands in Northern Ontario, called by governments and mining promoters the Ring of Fire. 10 First Nations in this region recently filed an historic lawsuit to assert their right to free, prior, and informed consent concerning any development on their territory, as well as for $95 billion in restitution for wealth illegally stolen from their territory since a 1905 treaty was signed. We pledge our solidarity with this First Nations lawsuit. We are also grateful for the voices, wisdom, ways of knowing, and leadership of Indigenous peoples in developing solutions to the Earth's climate and ecological crisis, and we commit to center them in our own climate action work. David Robertson is going to give an overview of the series we're beginning tonight. Over to you, David.
Thanks, John, for that powerful land acknowledgement and a call to action. So tonight is the first in a four-part series on resource extraction. Over the next few months, we're going to get a chance to explore the dimensions and to review some of the consequences of an economic model fueled by extraction. We will do so by examining four extraction industries: mining, forestry, aggregates, and industrial agriculture. Our focus will largely be Ontario, but the lessons learned will have, I believe, broader implications. So, why a series on resource extraction? In part, it's because we don't have the luxury of dealing with one crisis at a time. We're in a period of accelerating and multiple crises. We know the dimensions of the climate crisis and the urgency by which we need to act. We also know that the climate emergency is embedded, both cause and consequence, of a deeper ecological crisis. We're in a climate emergency, and we are at risk of ecological collapse. We also know that the major driver behind the climate crisis, the major threat of ecological collapse, is an economic system hell-bent on generating endless growth and never-ending profits for a tiny group of the world's population. And we know that the fallout, depleted resources, distorted economies, degraded commons, dispossessed peoples, are among the crises we need to address. In the four-part series, we're looking at two non-renewable resources, mineral and non-mineral mining, and two renewables, forests and soils, that because of the huge scale of extraction are becoming non-renewable. We have picked mineral mining because it will drive a wind, water, and solar energy transformation, and because of the paramount importance of Indigenous peoples and Indigenous rights. We picked timber extraction because it has turned our forests from carbon sinks to carbon sources. Aggregates, well, because of the concrete, the highway expansions, and relentless urban sprawl. And industrial agriculture, because it has mined the soil. Tonight's session, the first one on mining, is set within a context in Ontario and elsewhere in Canada of a fever pitch campaign to find and exploit minerals needed for renewable energy and low carbon products. Tonight's session will explore some of the issues and consequences of that campaign. It will point to some degree to the dark side of the green growth strategy. And it will set the stage for a discussion of how we build a different pathway. To introduce this evening's speaker, I'll turn to Terry Moore, a member of both Environment Haliburton and Seniors for Climate Action Now. And Terry has agreed to moderate tonight's session. Terry.
Well, thank you, David, for that. Before I actually introduce Jamie, I just wanted to say a couple of words about how we propose to handle the question and answer portion of the meeting this evening. So I'm going to ask you to place any questions that you have as they arise in the chat box so that you can, which you can activate by clicking on the chat box that's usually found at the bottom of your screen. But after Jamie's presentation, what I'll do is I'll go through the questions in chat and ask Jamie to respond. If there are a number of questions on the same theme, I may put them together and amalgamate them in or paraphrase them as a kind of a group. So we're planning to end tonight's event around 8:30 p.m. or so. But if there are more questions than can be addressed in that time period, Jamie is prepared to stay on for an extended period, which we're calling after chat, for about 20 minutes or so. After we call a formal end to the meeting, so we can carry on and try to answer more of those questions that people haven't got answered by 8:30. Okay, with those comments, I want to introduce Jamie Kneen. He's the Canada Program Co-Lead and Outreach Coordinator for MiningWatch Canada and does work on mining policy development and individual mining projects in Western and Northern Canada. In that capacity, Jamie takes a lead in formulating policy reform initiatives and providing strategic and technical support to communities affected by mineral exploration and mining projects. He also leads the organization's strategic research and communications efforts, as well as research and advocacy in Africa, previously Latin America, as well as on mine waste management, mining and Indigenous rights, uranium mining, and environmental assessment policy and practice in Canada. Jamie has a degree in biology, a major in ecology from McGill University, and has been involved with environmental and resource management issues, including mining, frequently related to indigenous land rights for many years. Jamie, it's a real pleasure to have you with us tonight to lead off our series of conversations on how key extractive industries are implicated in the climate emergency and the larger ecological crises that we're facing. Over to you to start this evening's conversation.
All right. Thank you, Terry. Thank you also, John. Thank you, David. Thank you, Susan, for that lovely series of introductions and orientations. I'm very happy to see quite a number of people here that I know, which is kind of exciting. So good job, everybody, for coming together. So really great to see folks. I was told that people really to have an outline and a presentation. So I did come up with a PowerPoint outline, which I'll use. So if you don't mind, I'm going to go to this presentation. I'm going to flip it into slideshow view, and I hope everyone is now seeing the actual title page.
Yes.
Great. So the first part is just talking about MiningWatch, and this is the boring part, but I think it's irrelevant. So MiningWatch came together in 1999, actually, out of a whole series of events and movements that were coming together at the time, which Joan Cooey has written about, a book called Unearthing Justice, which I highly recommend if people want to get more of the background on mining in Canada, the Canadian industry globally, and the kind of organizing that can be done around it. So that's my plug for the book. It's on, I believe it's Between the Lines. We'll make sure that link is shared around for folks who want to order it. But basically, in the 1990s, the Canadian industry was expanding globally. It was expanding into more and more remote parts of Canada. The Labrador and Inuit land claims were underway. The Nunavut land claim was coming together. And so there were big struggles happening between the mining industry and Indigenous and environmental groups across Canada at the same time that Canadian organizations operating internationally were coming back saying, the people we work with in Latin America and West Africa and in the Philippines are having problems with Canadian mining companies, and we don't really know what to do about it. So Mining One together response to all of that as a coalition of environmental, labor, Indigenous, faith-based groups, international development groups. And so we kind of assumed at the beginning that we were taking a really holistic view of things. We're not focusing on the environment or the economy or Indigenous rights or property rights, that all of these things are really part of the same set of problems that we're trying to address, and that the fundamental principles of social justice, environmental justice, and economic justice all kind of come together and work together and allow us to have a much more concrete and stronger view of the problems and the solutions that we're trying to promote. We work directly to support communities that are suffering the abuses of the mining industry, the human rights abuses, the environmental abuses, and to change the rules so that those things don't keep happening. Because we understand that while we can provide support and we can try to make change, case by case and make a difference, we can't prevent these things from happening without making more fundamental and systematic and systemic changes. But we're also small, so we're obliged to work in coalitions and networks. We don't have a huge staff. We've got 6 people and a dozen board members from across the country. So we have to work in coalitions and networks, but that's also, I think, our strength. We build our understanding of the world on the understanding that people have of their own situations. And so we see our work as one of really being a clearinghouse of trying to facilitate exchange of experience and information so that people can learn from each other and we can learn from them, and to focus on the frontline communities, the people whose experience and whose lives are really the ones that are hanging in the balance. The focus on the climate crisis really started to emerge a few years ago when we realized that the transition from carbon-based energy, from fossil fuels to renewables, was really a shift to mineral-based energy, because all of the elements of the renewable energy system and the whole transition, the generation of energy, solar, wind, et cetera, the transmission and storage, the battery power, are all based on mined minerals and manufactured components. And so to combat climate change, we are seeing the forecasts of increased demand for renewable energy driving a huge boom in the consumption of metals, and to some extent other, you know, sort of minerals like graphite, but we'll just call them all minerals or metals interchangeably for the sake of the conversation. And the implications of that increased demand are the pressure on communities and ecosystems that host that mining activity. Now, we also have to understand the nature of the mining industry, that it is inherently destructive, it is inherently unsustainable, it is a non-renewable resource, but it's also a resource that in its extraction, in its exploitation, creates huge amounts of waste that's often toxic and occasionally radioactive. So when you're mining metal, let's say something like copper, what you're producing is often more than 99% waste. In other words, we're extracting the metal, but what we're really producing is waste, a small portion of the material that's extracted and processed is actually used industrially, and the rest is left behind on the landscape, hopefully in a stable form, because these are often, like I say, often toxic. We've mobilized other heavy metals. We're only extracting the materials that we're interested in, and we're leaving behind all kinds of heavy metals and other contaminants that will be on the landscape permanently, and therefore have to be managed in a way that will protect the environment and protect us from it indefinitely. Mining also creates social conflict, and that can be characterized as, you know, the conflict of values. Mining creates interests locally and at all levels of business and politics, where some people are in on it and other people, for their own interests or their own values, are opposed to it. And so often we see this playing out as internal conflicts within communities, where some people are promoting mining or they're interested in it for some reason. They may genuinely see it as an economic savior, as providing jobs and income for people who desperately need them, or they may also be interested in it for their own sake, for their own business interests or their own political benefit, and different environmental interests. So the view of the environment, of natural resources, as something to be exploited or as systems to be protected and enjoyed and preserved and used for human and other benefits. So mining also produces inequality, because it's built on an extractivist colonial model where human and environmental costs are externalized and profits are concentrated. And the benefits of mining are never the same to the communities where the mining takes place as they are to those who own the mines, who benefit from the production and who then take those products and use them to add value, to build vehicles, to build buildings, to build whatever, you know, whatever the product is, because the like I say, the value of the labor, the value of the environmental damage are all assumed to be looked after elsewhere and not counted as part of the tremendous cost of those products. And so from the beginning, we've often talked about the true costs of mining and the true value of those materials. And that if we really place the kind of value on the items that we use, then we would treat them very differently, and we would treat the ecosystems and the communities that produce them very differently. So the trends that we're seeing, and this goes to, I think, some of the discussion that we're getting into, is that mining is expanding as it uses up the most easily accessible materials, the deposits that are higher grade and easier to get at. It's moving into more and more remote areas, into indigenous territories, into the headwaters of the rivers, into the glaciated areas of the mountains, but also at the same time, sometimes in populated areas. So whether that's Malartic in Quebec, or the mine that almost was built in Kamloops, right within the municipal boundaries and right where people actually already live in city, just in their, you know, indigenous remote areas and territories, where people will be, well, there are still people living there, but not in these. And, or in Africa, where, you know, huge area of people already engaged in agriculture, already using, you know, already using that land for their own subsistence, are displaced for the benefit of mining. As I say, as we use up the most, the richest ore, we're getting diminished ore grade, which means increased waste volume. So having to dig more ore out of the ground to produce the same amount of metal and trying to get more metal out of the ground at the same time just drives an exponential curve of increased extraction and increased waste volume, and, as I say, often toxic waste being produced in conditions that are not necessarily safe. It also produces increased conflict, because as mining moves into new areas, the people that live there, the people that are using that territory for their own agriculture, for their own harvesting, and the people who value those areas for cultural and spiritual reasons are going to be in conflict with the mining projects, the mining investment, and the pressure that comes with that. So, and this has driven a lot of the deadly conflict that we've seen globally and even occasionally in Canada, where violence is brought often by state actors, by the police and the military, occasionally by paramilitaries and mercenaries on behalf of mine company security, against communities and against people who are trying to resist this expansion of mining into their watersheds, into their traditional territories, into their agricultural lands, and so on. But the climate crisis is real. As David mentioned at the outset, you know, we're in the midst of a number of crises, and crises that are increasingly pressing on us in terms of biodiversity, in terms of fresh water, in terms of pollution, human inequality, migration. These are all part of the world that we live in and that we're tasked with trying to live responsibly in. What we've seen from some quarters, and I think from the environmental movement and the climate movement in the global north, we've seen a focus on decarbonization that often neglects the other dimensions of this. We started calling it the polycrisis because it's all around us and it's multidimensional, and actually makes them worse. So in other words, stopping fossil fuel extraction stops its direct environmental and social damage, but creates new social pressures in terms of employment, jobs, and a just transition for people working in those industries. But the what brings us here today, I think, is the expanding metal extraction that increases the damage from mining and leaves massive amounts of waste. So in making the other crises, the fresh water, the pollution crisis, the biodiversity crisis worse, worsening inequality and creating migration, pressure for migration for people that are displaced by mining. And it is building on and expanding and deepening those extractivist colonial relationships, both globally and domestically. So we're talking about people in the global north and in North America and Europe pushing for electrification and electric vehicles and transportation that will require huge amounts of material, which will be sourced from mines in the global south and in the colonized parts of our own country. So thinking of the Ring of Fire, but also one that's come up recently is the Long Point First Nation in Winnaway, Quebec, which is fighting against sound lithium. And, you know, it's very interesting. I was listening to a CBC What on Earth episode last year where the host sort of basically said, oh, but we need to solve this climate crisis and you have the lithium. So isn't it kind of your responsibility to mine that lithium and produce the lithium that we need for our electric vehicle batteries? And the Long Point First Nation chief at the time, Steve Matthias, basically said, that's not our problem. You made that problem. You should be dealing with it. You shouldn't be asking us after the last century of colonial expropriation and imposition on our territories, on our culture, on our way of life, to assume an even greater burden now that you're not willing to look after. The other thing is that the level of anticipated extraction is simply not realistic. So if you look at the projections from the World Bank, from the International Energy Agency, there was one calculation that sort of said, well, replacing all of the vehicles, all of the personal vehicles in the UK, in Great Britain alone, would require all of the battery metals of the entire world for the next decade. And they're talking about, you know, not just replacing them, but actually continuing to add more vehicles all the time. That's just, you know, so that's simply not feasible. And even if you sort of scale that back a little bit, mines just can't be built that quickly. There's a lot of complaining about the environmental assessment process, about the permitting and the restrictions on building new mines. And we've got Ontario just pushed through Bill 71 to try and accelerate the approval of new mines by dropping a lot of the restrictions on mine closure plans and things that would actually protect taxpayers as well as protecting the environment, protecting downstream communities from mine waste. But, my take on that is, to some extent, it doesn't really matter, because you still have to do the engineering if you actually want to build something that's going to physically hold together and produce what you want it to do. You're going to have to find the capital, but you're also going to have to make the engineering drawings and find the actual materials and people to build the mine. It's not going to happen that quickly. We've got an exploration boom happening now across Canada as people start looking for lithium and rare earth metals and so on and so forth. They haven't even found them in many cases. So, you know, and once you make a find and you start showing that there's actually substantial ore there that may be economical to mine, we're still talking another decade before those things can be built. And that's even with an accelerated process around environmental assessment. And even if we cut short the public engagement and the Indigenous consultation and consent processes, and if we're talking about implementing the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples and actually taking seriously the obligation to free, prior, and informed consent for Indigenous communities, that's not going to happen that quickly. And, you know, so on the one hand, the impacts of all of that mining would just be mind-boggling. At the same time, and what we've seen already referred to, the position of the Indigenous peoples themselves is not going to allow that to happen. They're not going to allow this to happen with their consent, and to make a meaningful investigation of what's being proposed and whatever modifications are required. This is not going to happen that quickly. And I fear that it will not happen without violent imposition. And we've already seen in Ontario and in Big Trout Lake, in Kitchen-Mixib and Inuwik, the KI-6, chief and counselors and one non-counselor who went to jail, were by the province of Ontario for stopping mining exploration in their territory. That's going to happen. The kind of militarization that we're seeing in Wet'suwet'en territory, that's going to get worse, not better, if this is the way that things are going to develop. Meanwhile, there's a lot of proposed solutions to fill that metal demand as well as all of that mining. So we can mine the wastes. We can look at what's in the landfills. There was one factoid going around a while ago that as the US shifted from copper telephone cables to optical cables, that the largest copper deposit in the United States was actually the municipal landfills. Reprocessing all of that waste and the construction waste, copper pipes and so on that are just, getting dumped in landfills. Anyway, all of that can, all of that can be re-mined and reprocessed, and maybe even processed in a way that will make it safer and produce less methane and toxic leakage over time. The same is true of the tailings dumps, the waste dumps from old mines where the mine processing was less efficient. Or, as I said earlier, you're only extracting and selling some of the metals, not all of them, out of the waste. And there's the opportunity to go back and reprocess those tailings with greater efficiency. And again, unlike Ontario, you could say that's also an opportunity to make them safer and to reduce the probability of spillage or seepage over time of toxic elements into the water supply. But that's a limited supply. So, that it does exist, it will make a difference. It's not enough to really push us through the kind of the level of metal consumption that's required to make all of these wind turbines and transmission lines and batteries and electric motors. Recycling is also promoted, and it is true that recycling will help. The problem is that to get to the level of material in circulation that can then be recycled, we need to add a whole bunch. So again, looking at things like electric vehicles, well, we've only got a few of them on the road now, 1 in 10 maybe if you're lucky. There's a huge amount of new material needed to build up a supply that can then be recycled. And then the additional problems of, the energy efficiency and the physical and chemical efficiency of all of that recycling. So it takes a fair bit of work to recycle things. They also have to be designed better so that they can be recycled without a lot of waste. And I'm just mentioning the right to repair as one of the elements of, actually being able to maintain things and having products that are built to be repaired and refurbished and not just scrapped and recycled as an additional bonus. So these are all important elements, but as I say, they'll make a big difference, but not enough and not soon enough. The other aspect to that is that if batteries last for a decade, let's say, or wind turbines last for 25 or 30 years, the recycling is, it's kind of problematic on its own, but it also won't really kick in for some time. there's also new technology all the time, new battery technology in particular, using different metals, using different chemistries. And this is definitely a factor, but it's also one that, again, makes the whole thing a bit more unpredictable, but it doesn't reduce all of the demand for new metal mining. Then we get into the crazy stuff. So we've got one Canadian mining company promoting deep sea mining. And there's a whole story there that I won't get into. It's on our website. We've actually got a separate website called Stop Deep Sea Mining. But this is the insane idea that we can just scoop the metallic nodules off of the deep sea bed, or that we can send little tractors down to knock over the hot water vents and the metallic chimneys that are built around them, that have built up over millennia, millions of years actually, on the seafloor, and that we can do this without destroying environments that we don't even know anything about. And then there's the really crazy stuff about mining the moon or asteroids, and somehow I haven't quite figured out how they think that that's going to balance out in terms of energy use, that we'll actually be able to mine the moon or mine the asteroids without wasting way more energy than we're getting out of it. So the core of the problem, I think, is summed up with the quote of supposedly Einstein. There's no proof that he had this, but it's a great quote: trying to solve a problem using the same thinking that created it. Or the more folksy sort of adage: when you find yourself in a hole, the first thing to do is stop digging. We're not doing that. We're looking at digging more, faster. How to approach this, I think, is David kind of stole some of what might have here in terms of the moral crisis and the need to live within our means. So Kate Raworth has done some really neat framing of this. She talks about donutnomics. So it's not it's not one, it's a circle. And if you look at all of different sort of segments of this circle, they call it a pie, but basically if you look at things like freshwater use, arable land, deforestation, we're way and consumption, we collectively, so human beings, are way overshooting what the earth can supply. And so in material use, it would take three earths to produce enough material for everyone to live the way that a German does. For everyone to live the way that a Canadian or an American lives would take more like 10. It's ridiculous. So we have to live within our means. This is not the same in all of the dimensions. So things like chemical pollution are definitely a crisis, but are still within the capacity of natural systems to handle them to some extent. I really don't like relying on natural resilience to look after our mess. We should be looking after it ourselves. But her thing is, and the reason she calls it a donut, is there's a zone there where we could be consuming that which can be replenished, where the earth systems, the ecological systems can recover, and we can live and enjoy some technologies and some benefits, and just not quite at the level that we're at. Because, again, the problem is really one of overconsumption, of waste and inefficiency that are really driven by profit and induced need. So, we don't need more new cars, new doodads, bigger things all the time. We're told that by advertising, by capitalism, because that's the only way that we can still keep consuming these things, is that if there is waste, if there is inefficiency, and that's how profit is made. And unfortunately, that's also how our pension funds keep themselves going, is by keeping that system and profiting from it. So the challenge really is to reconfigure economies at all levels to address real needs, not artificial ones, not luxury, but actual needs. And, you know, what I don't know and what I haven't really seen the analysis of is to what, what is the actual sort of living a level that let's say North Americans should be at, that then Africans or Asians could aspire to, and that would leave us all in a sense of global equity and justice with access to clean water, to adequate housing, to useful levels of transportation, to get us where we need to go, to keep our foods and medicines cold when we need them to be, to heat up the food and our home, we need those to be heated, to cut the waste, but provide what people actually need. That's a challenge. And, you know, that can be implemented at all levels. So the other thing is, there's a lot of discussion around, nuclear energy, small modular reactors, around carbon capture and transport, around all of these things that are hugely expensive, hugely inefficient, and don't actually work yet, as somehow these things are going to save us. And we can continue on our merry way, basically business as usual, and this technology is going to save us. It would be nice if it happened. I really think it's a really poor investment, because what we need to do is invest in the technologies that we have and the concepts that we have and the systems that we know, because it exists. We know how to build transit. We know how to do agriculture. We know how to build efficient houses. We know how to build smaller houses that are appropriate to smaller families, and not to continue to build ridiculous suburbs and all. And that's part of my response to this also, is that change has to come from the ground up. These are all things that need to be coordinated globally, that require global political action, but also have to be built in communities and not just individual action, but collective action. So I was talking earlier about the right to repair. Well, there's things like, little things that add up, like tool libraries. Apparently, the average cordless drill is used for about 12 minutes. So I know some that have been used until they fall apart, hundreds and hundreds of hours. So that's not those, which means that the law of averages, that some of them are being, once for one IKEA project, and that's it. That's ridiculous, right? So things like tool libraries, where you can just coordinate so that there's people that need a drill for their IKEA project can get one, and they can put it back, and it's there for the next person to use. Again, talking about the circular economy, well, the three R's start with reducing demand, and then reusing things, and then recycling, and the three R's just expand that out. But it still starts with reducing demand. And it's interesting, one of the papers that Terry's put in his little resource kit is about vehicle size, and looking at the demand for lithium for electric vehicle batteries in the context of not just how many electric vehicles we're building, but also how big they are, and the fact that, electric pickup trucks and electric Humvees and huge electric SUVs are using many times more metal than smaller cars. And even if North America just used European sized cars, which we were for a while there in the 70s and 80s, it would be a lot more manageable. But the bottom line is that electric cars exist to save the auto industry, not to save the climate. And my closing statement really is, with all of this discussion of critical minerals, these minerals, all of this mining is critical for profit, it's critical for capitalism. There's no such thing as critical minerals. Clean water is critical. I'll stop there. Thanks very much.
So I want to thank you for that, Jamie. I think that set out a whole series of considerations that are going to have to be present as we try to come to grips with the contradictions associated with an energy transition and the realities associated with increased, not decreased, sort of mineral and energy throughput that comes along with that, and get our heads around, I guess, the darker side of green, and figure out how we're going to end up at a lower level of energy and material consumption that's compatible, as you were saying, with regard to the biogeophysical systems of the earth that supports all life. So I want to thank you very much for that. I want to just take a minute to remind people that now's the time to put comments and questions into the chat function, and I will attempt to try to go through those in sequence in just a minute or so. So you know, please take the time to put whatever questions you have into the chat box, and I'll go through them in sequence. So one thing that Jamie mentioned is that we're producing a resource list, and that will be coming out to you sometime tomorrow, in which we will give you some resources that if you want to take a deeper dive or even a shallow dive into some of these issues, there's a number of resources that we're making available to you to facilitate that. So that'll be coming out sometime tomorrow. So I'm going to go and start the Q&A though with asking Sherry Hillman from SCAN's Indigenous Solidarity Committee to pose the first question to Jamie. So Sherry, can you start things off?
Sure. And yes, lots of food for thought there. Thanks so much, Jamie. I want to focus a little more on one aspect you touched on. When I saw the flyer for this webinar, the statement, "The impact of mineral extraction on humans," got me wondering about what all those impacts would be. But that statement also made me think about how it doesn't impact all humans equally. Mm-hmm. For Indigenous peoples on whose territory most of the mineral extraction occurs, it impacts inherent rights, sometimes treaty rights, their culture, and traditional lifestyles of hunting, fishing, and trapping. And in some of the cases you've cited, health, with the waste and stuff that these companies leave behind in extracting the minerals. And this current rush, I'm thinking particularly of Ontario here, to extract critical minerals, I see it as a modern day gold rush, and the gold rush led to the theft of so much Indigenous lands across Turtle Island, but this one threatens Indigenous lands, sovereignty, and despite the fact that we're supposedly in an era of reconciliation, it undermines all of that and goes in the opposite direction. But the heartening thing is that First Nations in this modern day, gold rush or mineral rush, they're resisting and asserting their rights. And I'm thinking here of particularly, you cited some really important cases, the KI and internationally as well. But I'm thinking of current cases, the lawsuits, in Treaty 9 territory, the 10 First Nations that are taking on the Ford government attempt to push ahead and develop in the ring, and also the Gitxala First Nations lawsuit in British Columbia challenging BC's Mineral Tenure Act, and how also using provincial UNDRIP legislation to challenge, Section 91 provinces' jurisdiction over resources. Those can all have really profound effects, I think, and I find them really exciting and wonder if you could comment on that and how you see that strategic thinking in alliances that are formed and how we as environmental activists and allies can plan our strategies moving forward.
Well, that's a big question. Thank you. Thank you, Sherry. I mean, you mentioned a lot of the things that I would have put into the answer as well, in terms of, you know, if the impact mining start well before mining actually happens. So the Kikatla case is actually about mine staking, and the fact that when prospectors come and, well, when they went up, they don't even come onto the land at this point. They go on the internet and they stake a claim on a territory, and then they have a legal interest in that territory. And the Kikatla Nation has gone to court to say, that is our territory. We have a governance system, we have a legal system, and they've explained all that to the court now, and we'll see where that ends up. But the point is that the province of BC is going ahead and creating a legal interest, which is actually worth money, on someone else's territory, and you know, without permission, without even notification, and certainly without consent. So, you know, it starts at the very beginning, and then it goes all the way through. And so I think one of the things to understand about free, prior, informed consent is, like any other form of consent, it's not a checkbox. It's not a one-off agreement. It's not a condition that, you know, we set something out and sign it and we're done. And I think, you know, that's also true of the treaties. They were people, the indigenous peoples never understood those as a deed of sale. They understood it as an agreement to a relationship. And so, you know, if we just look at the mining process, so consent is something that has to be negotiated at every step of the way to say, what is it that we agree is going to happen next? So, you know, and I kind of resist the term reconciliation, because the re implies that there was something equal to be recaptured. And I, you know, what we're looking at is trying to actually build something anew, something that works, that was, you know, that was never properly built in the first place. You know, so what we're seeing is Indigenous peoples and First Nations across the country and internationally claiming those rights and standing on them, and, you know, in getting some surprising legal recognition, getting some violent repression as well. And so I think, you know, on the one hand, it's great, and it's fantastic that they have the legal standing to make these claims, you know, to push back against the, you know, all aspects of this, and say, you know, whether it's the claim staking, or whether it's the pollution, or the abandoned mines, at the end of the day, you know, they have the recognition and ability to push back on these things, and we need to be supporting that. But it's also a, you know, something that we need to take responsibility for directly, and as the Diné activist Klee Ben Ali has said, we need accomplices, not allies. So people that are actually there with us, not, you know, not encouraging us or outside, but actually taking some risks. And I think that's really the challenge to settlers, is to figure out, you know, what are the risks that we're going to take to make things happen. I don't know if that answers your question. I hope so. One more thing. I would say the gold rush never actually ended. You know, it's still happening across the country. You know, what was happening in Kikatla there was a gold mine. Gold is actually the most important mining product that Canada has. It's worth more than nickel, worth more than copper, worth more than coal. You know, and yet it's not actually something that we need. So that's something about as well. Terry.
Okay, so I'm going to go and run through some of the questions in the chat box, and start with one where which really inviting you to say some more things, I guess, about or a little bit deeper into whether or not you see some positive inroads in the recycling of minerals that will somehow reduce the demand and connect with a kind of a circular economy, you know, view of things where the waste becomes a resource and not just something to bury or just to try to forget, and as opposed to trying to, in the end, taking pressure off the development of new mining and new mineral extraction operations.
Yeah, I mean, there's definitely potential there. And I think really the major obstacle is probably capitalism itself. So the fact that the profit motive is what we rely on to make this happen. And so, you know, I mean, that's why I've got multi-metallic waste happening, because it's only profitable to extract one or two things out of that mix and the rest is left as waste. And also why, you know, the proper measures aren't taken to do it safely, because it's more profitable to cut corners. So, you know, there's two ways around that. And one's a legal mandate to do something, to say, whether it's a state company or, you know, whatever the formulation, doesn't really matter, but to say, as metals are mined or as wastes are remined, that we will extract everything. We will process everything. We will make it as safe as possible. And the other is by regulation. So to require that as a condition of action, and both of those will make it not profitable, you know. So as long as we're relying on the market to finance all of this activity and to organize the consumption, that's going to be a central problem. So, you know, I think there's definitely room for that. But there are also serious drawbacks, and you know, we will see those in Ontario fairly soon if the government, the Ford government, has its way.
Okay, so there's a sort of a related question having to do with transportation and the need to move the emphasis from individual modes of transportation to more collective modes, and the creation of you know, more public transit for moving mm-hmm. people from A to B, and the potential there for being able to, you know, to not have as much extraction down the road, because we'd be concentrating on more social forms of transport. What's your yeah. thought about that? Is that, I mean, that would be, you indicated in your presentation that that's useful, but can that make a significant contribution to reducing, you know, mineral extraction?
Oh, I think it's critical. And the groups in Quebec a couple of years ago had actually calculated that it would make more of a difference in CO2 emissions to get people, you know, like, let's say in Montreal and Quebec City, at least in the urban centers, get people massively on diesel buses rather than electric cars. That, you know, and that's part of why I say we need to use the technology we have, because, you know, once people on public transit, then you can work on electrifying it. That may take a few years, but the diesel buses are now, we should be using them, and we should be, you know, then moving as quick as possible to electrify them. But, you know, it's also a question of making sure that those systems are accessible and affordable and useful, so that they actually get used, so that they expand, you know, into rural areas, so that rural people have access. You know, I fail to understand how any government in Canada allowed Greyhound to fold. You know, this was a lifeline for rural communities, for First Nations, for poor people and women in particular, and young people who don't have vehicles to, you know, anyway, that this is the social aspect that has a huge climate implication as well. So that's, you know, there's lots of good ideas, and, you know, things like trolley buses in cities are fantastic. They don't work in really nasty weather, unfortunately, and so Ottawa might not be the best place for them, but you know, there's lots of potential there and smart use of the material so that, again, you know, if you've got a bus that can recharge at the end of its route, it doesn't need to have the same relative amount of battery power. So all of the benefits of public transit kind of get multiplied. Lots of potential there, and lots of, you know, and lots of, I think, again, you know, smart technology that exists that needs to be deployed.
Okay, so one of the questions that we've been hearing a lot about lately is the capacity of a switch to renewables and a much lower level of resource impact extraction and energy use than is currently used by the fossil fuel industry, by that the fossil fuel cycle, and that by definition that's going to have a smaller environmental footprint than sticking with fossil fuels. What I mean, you've been mentioning that may not necessarily be the case. So what's your thinking about the impact of a transition to renewables in terms of the material throughput and energy throughput that would result in?
The calculations, the estimates vary widely, like orders of magnitude. But what I've seen so far is that a lot of those estimates, a lot of those arguments completely ignore the waste. So you're ignoring 99% of what mining produces, and the toxic waste that it produces. So on the one hand, not mining coal and not burning oil and so on is really important. You know, we absolutely need to make that happen sooner rather than later. But in terms of the tons of material being extracted, it's actually not that necessarily that different. And it depends on the mix. Like I say, the calculations that I've seen are all over the map, but they agree that there's significant amounts of material that have to be processed to produce the metals. And that's, like I say, that's often left out of those calculations, and it's actually super important because it go away. I mean, when you burn fossil fuels, you just move the waste into the atmosphere. And when you process metals, you're leaving it in the watershed on the surface. So, you know, neither one is great.
Okay, so there's someone who's written in the chat box about wanting to know more about the waste materials from mining. You mentioned a book that was produced by a former director in MiningWatch Canada. Are there other things that you would point people to if they want some information, more information about the waste material and you know, its implications? From mining.
Yeah, we've got quite a bit of material, like more general sort of primers on these issues, but also more detailed recommendations for, you know, specific to different areas about what needs to be done to protect communities and watersheds from spills and disasters of that nature. So if people want to bug me directly, you know, email me, I'll try and connect you up with whatever the resources are, so you don't have to just, you know, poke around on our website. Okay,
so there's been a lot of talk about net zero, of course, in recent years, and that net zero would actually result in fewer amounts of metal having to be extracted in order to support a growing economy. Can you say a few words about that? What your take is on that?
I'm afraid it doesn't work. We've seen so far, you know, there's this idea of decoupling economic growth from consumption, and from specifically from energy consumption and fossil fuel use, and the only place that happened was briefly Germany with the 2008 financial crisis. So didn't really have to do with technology or shifting energy consumption. It just had to do with an economic downturn and the fact that Germans kept doing stuff. So they kept having an economy, but they weren't actually burning as much fossil fuel for a little while. So it doesn't, unfortunately, the evidence is that that doesn't connect up. And of course, the problem with net zero is that it leaves lots of room for carbon capture and storage, or planting trees that already exist, or you know, more trees than exist in the world, to do that offset.
Okay, so
I was just going to say there's a resource called Hoodwinked in the Hothouse, which was produced by Indigenous Climate Action and the Indigenous Environmental Network and a handful of other groups around the, they've got like three editions out now. So the last one, I think, was for the Glasgow Convention of the Parties. It's an excellent resource that really talks about carbon offsets and the false solutions that are being sold because they're profitable, not because they work.
Okay. Someone has asked a question with respect to environmental assessments in this country and how your view about, you've had some experience with environmental assessments as applied to, you know, extractive industries and proposals to develop this mine or that mine. So is that system fundamentally broke? Can it be fixed? What would be the things that would be necessary in order to fix it?
Yeah, I have way too much experience with environmental assessment. It's pretty badly damaged if it's not completely broken. You know, the current federal legislation has some really interesting pieces in it. So things like gender-based analysis, looking at social impacts, actually looking at sustainability and you know, having the potential to challenge some of the promises and sales pitches that were given about, you know, how these projects are going to produce jobs, are going to produce royalties and benefits and all this that often do not materialize in the way they're presented. So, you know, on the one hand, there's some interesting potential there, but on the other hand, it now applies to maybe less than half of the mining projects in Canada. And if the Supreme Court doesn't like it, it's actually being challenged by Alberta in the Supreme Court. And we may not have a federal impact assessment law in 6 months' time. So, but it's also, yeah, I mean, it's been rewritten first by the Harper government and then by the Trudeau government, but in the same mold to really limit public engagement, to really limit the assessment of alternatives and to really speed up the process. So there's really no opportunity to have a good critical assessment of what's being proposed and what its impacts and implications really will be.
Okay, so maybe a sort of a side comment with respect to the environmental assessments that are going on with respect to the Ring of Fire. What's the status of that? And I know that there's competing, at least there appears to be competing environmental assessments federally. And then there's a regional environmental assessment that's been overlaid across the entire process. Will any of that actually raise important questions that would cause the project to be fundamentally altered?
Yeah, so there are seven assessment processes underway for three separate projects each have a federal and a provincial assessment process. And then there's the federal regional assessment. So I'm not sure which one to tackle first. The more interesting one, I think, is the federal one. And that is at the moment in a bit of a regrouping, because the feds had negotiated a terms of reference with the province of Ontario And as you can imagine, anything that Ontario agrees with is not going to be terribly useful. So it was not terribly useful. And groups like ours, Wildlife Conservation, Canadian Environmental Law Association, et cetera, joined many of the First Nations to call out that process. And so they, to their credit, Minister Guilbeault and the feds backed up and said, okay, we're going to try and do this properly. And they're now negotiating with all of the First Nations in the region on terms of reference that everyone can agree on. So, you know, and that will take some time, and it, you know, should have been done 15 years ago, but it's better late than never. And it does look a bit more promising. The other assessments are all for these road segments. So Webequa First Nation, Martin Falls First Nation have each set themselves up as the proponents of specific road segments. And then there's a third segment that joins those. And so each of those is undergoing, a provincial and a federal assessment. And at least federally, I think that is probably illegal, but somebody has to challenge it, somebody with standing. So one of the groups that lives there has to challenge that in court. You know, Mining Watch went to court, 12 years ago, 13 years ago to challenge that idea of an environmental assessment that is, you know, splitting a project into pieces so that you can't actually get a picture of what's going on. And so we've got kind of two opposite things going on. We've got assessments that are broken up in a way that you'll never get a picture of the real impacts. And then we've got a regional assessment that will take a really long time, but will get us more of an overview of what the, you know, what the impacts will be to those communities and to that environment.
Okay, so sticking with the Ring of Fire or the Breathing Lands for a minute, there's a question about whether or not there's been a thorough analysis done of the quantities and types of minerals and the market value and the companies, what the level of interest the companies, the economic interest that's at stake here for the companies, are the companies involved primarily multinational or foreign, or is there some domestic participation as well?
Well, the one main company that's still involved is Australian owned at this point. And there's definitely metal there, nickel, chromite, and so on. And probably quite a lot of it, but what it's actually worth is a really good question, because the economics have to balance out and the costs of developing. I mean, we've got the province of Ontario and the feds fighting over paying billions and billions of dollars just to build a road. And, you know, never mind what it will take to actually develop the mine. And of course the mining companies are trying to play taxpayers against each other so that, you know, they don't actually have to pay for any of this. They want to get the infrastructure, the power supply and everything else for as close to free as they can. And then, but they'll still have to build the mines themselves. And the definition, the legal definition of ore is rock that is economically viable to mine. So it doesn't matter what's in it if it's not economically viable. And there's been some really interesting coverage of this and how it was, you know, it's at one point, a geologist actually said it might be worth $60 billion. And he's now said that was really silly and irresponsible of him. And he you know, doesn't agree with that at all. Meanwhile, the Ontario Minister Peary is talking about like, oh, maybe it's worth $100 billion, or maybe it's infinite. And then challenge on that has absolutely no idea where he got those numbers from.
Okay. And the Ontario government, of course, is claiming that the Ring of Fire, the Breathing Lands developments are actually essential to as part of dealing with the climate emergency. So is that purely and simply greenwashing? Or is there any truth to the idea that there's a connection between, you know, the ore that's in the ground in that neck of the woods and a renewable energy transition?
Well, if they're going to mine nickel, and if the nickel is going to be used in batteries, then yes, there's some, you know, there's some connection there. The chromite would be used to make stainless steel. So, I mean, industrially used, but not for energy. And there may be rare earth elements that are useful for electric motors and turbines and so on. So maybe. But, you know, as I say, the costs and the technical challenges of doing this at all are immense. And I don't know if it's greenwashing or just old-fashioned hucksterism to keep waving this thing around and telling people what a great thing it is. And, you know, I'm going to jump on the bulldozer myself to make it happen.
Okay, so there is a question about just transition and the need to appeal and to working class Canadians as we try to build a kind of a climate movement that's capable of being able to build a progressive transition from our current energy system and our current economy to one that is capable of remaining within planetary boundaries. So how do you've had some experience in attempting to work with the labor movement. How do you see, what we should be doing in order to try to win more people over to the notion that a just transition is essential as we try to grapple with an energy transition?
Yeah, and I think this has political and economic dimensions. And, you know, the part of the problem is, how much of the Maritimes is dependent on work in Alberta in the oil patch to keep their families fed. So it's not just Albertans, it's big chunks of the country that are dependent on that. It's an interesting problem, in the sense that there's a lot of work in renewable energy, but it's much more precarious work. The kind of stable long-term work that you have in mining or in oil and gas, although obviously, especially in the last little while, the last decade, oil and gas has been up and down a lot. But those are good union jobs. And we're asking people to go to much more unstable and actually less protected and more dangerous work in solar installation and so on. So there's lots of potential there, but it really needs to be supported. And there are a lot of groups, unions and allied groups, and that we're working with as well to push the federal and provincial governments in particular to support that transition and to support those workers, so that we're pretty sure there's a lot of work to be done, but there's a lot of support that's needed to stabilize that, to keep it unionized, to keep it safe, to try and systematize things so that it does actually provide not just the income but the conditions that those workers have that really all workers should be having. And there's a footnote there that part of the definition of green jobs is actually goes into what we could call the economy of the future, which is not just renewable energy and cleaning up the mess from past fossil fuel and mining projects, but actually looking after the retired workers, looking at in healthcare, in elder care, and all of the typically feminized and immigrant workforces that are have been called essential workers but not treated with any respect. So that's the other dimension of a just transition, I think, is to ensure that you know, what we call green jobs as this huge broad definition, and brings all workers into a fair workplace and a fair treatment, and not, you know, not only the ones that are already privileged. I don't mean to call union work privilege, but it is a much better position, and you know, it's something that people fought for generations, that they now need to keep and that we need to try and match.
So there's a question that touches on an issue related to that, and that's that, assuming that some mining is necessary for the foreseeable future, that we're going to actually have to engage in what you by definition characterize as unsustainable activity, almost by definition. Mm-hmm. That you make it better, but you can't make it fully sustainable. Is what's the role for the public sector and not-for-profit agencies and being able to, or entities, and being able to actually get profit out of the way and advance the energy transition in a way which is more progressive, and which is going to treat people in a much more equitable manner?
That is an excellent question, and one that I don't have much of an answer for, because there are lots of different models of how to do that. And so, you know, we've been focused on the regulatory approach. I mentioned that before, as you know, trying to ensure that the regulations are in place, that the regulations are as tough as possible, that the conditions for the mining that does have to happen are as positive as possible, you know, so that things are being done safely, so that the, you know, workers and the environment are being protected, communities are being protected, and the metals that we actually need are being produced. And of course, this is being done in territories and with the consent of the nations. So the alternative is direct public investment. There are a couple of approaches. So the US actually is investing directly in junior mining companies, but they're also talking about, they haven't gone here yet, but they're talking about stockpiling. So there are, you know, because of the trade agreements that we've, free trade agreements that we're part of, and international law, governments can't actually legally restrict the production of private companies, but they could stockpile the products, and they could say, look, we're going to guarantee a supply of lithium, copper, whatever it is, by stockpiling the product and by paying a fixed price, so that then we know that those producers can afford the conditions that we're imposing on them. And we also know that the industry is going to have the raw materials that it needs. There are other sort of other models underway, and I frankly, I don't think a lot of them are very convincing, where both Mexico and Chile have moved to nationalize their lithium, but in a public-private partnership model that is, it's a public-private partnership model, so it's deeply flawed. It's guaranteeing profit out of public resources, which is the wrong way to do things. And you know, so because again, it's leaving the profit motive in the driver's seat, as it were. Where, you know, I think what you're talking about, Terry, and what we're trying to get to is actually making that a secondary consideration, if it's even part of the picture.
Okay, we're getting close to 8:30, and there's still a bunch of questions in chat, but I'll put this question, then we'll figure out what we're going to do from here on in. There's a question that in part talks about the climate emergency being, you would think, the necessary incentive to get the private sector and governments on side with really doing stuff to protect the environment and social, social rights, and so that to deal, so we can deal adequately with this in a collective way. I mean, there's lots of people who are always wondering about why it is that the you know, that the powers that be are really not pushing as fast and as hard as they really want, that, you know, the crisis would call us, you know, call on us to do. So, mm-hmm. No, I mean, as opposed to just simply, you know, trying to deal with this crisis on our own as individuals, you pointed out that the solutions are collective. How do we get from where we are to where we need to be? And do you see, what do you see as necessary in order to get the private sector on side with the climate emergency and the urgent need to do something, you know, under the current, you know, economic system?
That's a tough one, because I think part of the problem is actually the way that the system has been structured over recent decades, and the degree to which finance has become its own thing. So we call this financialization, right? And we see that there are trillions and trillions of dollars offshore that are outside of any jurisdiction, that are being managed by major hedge funds, and we don't have any legal control over of that. We have some influence over it through major investment vehicles, primarily pension funds. So, you know, the Church of England pension fund has done a lot of work to push the mining industry towards safer waste practices. It's not, you know, they've got a long, long ways to go, but they actually had enough leverage. They said, hey, we've got, you know, I don't know, several trillion dollars that they have invested. And that's enough to make the industry sit up and pay attention. You know, getting private funds like BlackRock to do the same is, I think, just not realistic. And that's one of the issues I have with a lot of the work that's gone into climate divestment, is that money is simply moved somewhere else. And one fund will divest from coal, but there's enough money in the financial system to simply pick that up and carry on. And you see that those coal operations, for instance, that have been dumped by major investors are simply picked up and if anything, are more profitable afterwards. So, you know, it's a really tough one because of that. And again, part of the answer to that is to start pulling money out of that system. It'd be really nice to just make it illegal. I don't know why it's legal to have offshore funds like that. You know, there's why companies are allowed to have subsidiaries offshore and move money, you know, out of the country being restricted. I don't know that's why that's even allowed. But as long as it is, the only other thing that we can do is start pulling money out of those things, and not just not divesting from them, but actually investing on purpose in more useful, productive things. And, you know, and I would say much more local things that we can actually control. So whether that's, you know, a local wind co-op or an agricultural endeavor of some kind, like community shared agriculture, there's all kinds of models, and I think all of useful proposals that people just can't get funding for from the banks and these institutions. So we, you know, that, and that's, I think that's been on the agenda of a lot of community development people for a long time. You know, if the developers won't build social housing, well, who's going to? If the city doesn't have the money and the province doesn't care, how does it happen?
So it's 8:30. It's past 8:30, actually, the nominal end point that we had established for the meeting. So there's a number of questions that are still in chat. So I think what I'll do is really call a formal end to the meeting, but invite people who are interested and who are able to stick around, and we'll do some after chat for a while to see how we can chip away at the questions that remain in the chat box or any new ones that appear. So I want to thank everybody for attending tonight. Thank you, Jamie, for an excellent presentation, and for the work that you do, and for the work that MiningWatch Canada does. So I would like then to move from the formal part of the meeting and invite everybody who's still participating in the discussion to stick around, and we'll do another 20 minutes or so of questions and answers and see where that takes us. So thank you for participating. We'll be in touch soon with respect to the resource list for tonight, but also with respect to information about the other parts of this series, this extraction series, that will include the industrial forestry, industrial agriculture, and the aggregate industry in particular. So thank you, and we'll just take a quick few seconds of to transition to the after chat. Thank you very much for attending. Okay, so Jamie, thank you for this, and there are, like I said, a number of questions that remain on the list to work our way through, and one of them has to do with how, and I guess it connects to the just transition or to the building of a movement that's capable of being able to move the yardsticks on not just mineral extraction, but the climate emergency more directly, and deal with the louder voices that are obviously in the ears of the folks who are in policymaking positions. What do you see as the role for a guaranteed income in building the kind of movement that's necessary and in getting people on side, and perhaps chipping away at that dependency that keeps people, tethered, to the existing extraction system and the fossil fuel sector?
I think it's a great idea. I know there are some concerns from, I think particularly some of the public sector unions about the potential for guaranteed basic income to undermine their gains. But as far as I've looked at, I think those concerns can be addressed, and basically, and as long as the implementation is thought through properly, then definitely the potential is huge.
Now, there's someone who's put a question with respect to Mark Jacobson as a proponent that exclusive, that the possibility exists, not just the possibility, but the reality exists that renewable energy can, in fact, power our entire economy and a growth-oriented economy. And more recently, he's talked about there being enough lithium in the Salton Sea in southwestern United States to supply all of North America's needs. And he's been talking about the fact that lithium, or he claims that lithium is endlessly recyclable. What do you think about these claims that we can power an endlessly growing economic system on the basis of renewables, and that mm-hmm. there's enough lithium, to power all of North America's needs?
Well, it's a peculiarly American way of thinking that, it's kind of manifest destiny. We'll keep expanding and keep going and keep conquering new frontiers without ever having to take responsibility for what we've already stepped on. And so on the one hand, I think he's a smart guy. I really appreciate the fact that he does not see things like nuclear as part of that equation. But at the same time, the idea of infinite growth is not that the planet can afford. And the only way you can make that work, is by looking at energy to the exclusion of everything else. And sure, there's huge amounts of lithium in the Salton Sea, but by the time you finish extracting it, you've got a toxic brine. You've upset the water balance of the area, and you've created a toxic sludge of leftover, everything that's not lithium. And I think, we didn't get into this in the talk so far, but this is part of the discussion is around sacrifice zones and the fact that You know, Bill McKibben's has similar arguments about electrifying. And, you know, like I say, on the one hand, you know, electrification has to happen. It's a question of how far we go and how that's implemented so that it doesn't end up making things worse. Just like I think electric vehicles it's a superior technology. We should have been doing that all along. You know, it's not too late to switch, but they're still cars, and all of the problems of, you know, pedestrian deaths and tire pollution and so on, and just roads, all have to do with vehicles, not with whether they're electric or internal combustion. You know, so again, it's sort of a yes and no kind of answer, but I appreciate, you know, especially in the American context where it is, you know, either communist or just un-American to talk about restricting economic activity or private property in any sense, then, you know, he's making an argument that has to be made in an American context. But I think that the, you know, the Democratic Socialists and the Green New Deal are at least going in the right direction when they're tackling that. And obviously they've also been criticized for not going far enough and by, you know, leaving too much of the profit motive intact and not enough of the social needs being looked after. I don't know if that answers your question.
I think it makes it helps getting us towards an answer to the question, but and we can only, I think, begin the process in conversations like this, and it's going to be important to carry on the discussions that we're starting. There's a question about investor state provisions built into more than 40 of Canada's free trade agreements. And the question is really about, I think, the impediment that this makes, or the leverage this gives, you know, to corporations to basically control, you know, public policy because of the threat of being able to sue, you know, sovereign states, you know, for actions which affect, you know, their rate of return, the amount that they expect to make on their investments. How big a barrier do you think these investor state provisions are for Canada getting its act together with respect to reining in corporate control over our energy and you know energy and material mineral policies? I guess I could put it that way.
Yeah, they are significant. So we did manage to persuade the Canadian government to get rid of what used to be Chapter 11 in NAFTA, so the new whatever it's called, Mexico, Canada, U.S. free trade, NAFTA 2.0, cut that out of the relationship between Canada and the U.S., which was the one where Canada lost out most, left it in place for Mexico, which isn't really fair. But then all of the other, you know, the European trade agreement, all these other ones still have that in place. So there's still lots of potential. And we've discovered that even the kinds of modifications that Canada has been putting in, sort of trying to carve out exclusions for environmental protection or for climate action, don't actually work when they get to the trials. So if there is a, you know, if a case is launched, if an investor doesn't like what's happened, we had a case last year, a Canadian mining company suing the Colombian government, and Canada actually told the arbitrators that we didn't want that to happen, that there is language in the Canada-Colombia Free Trade Agreement that's supposed to allow Colombia to protect its environment without being threatened with this kind of lawsuit. And the arbitrator said, we don't care. We still think it was unfair. So it doesn't matter what's in the agreement even. And, you know, so the long story short, we need to get rid of those. It's a deadly system, and not just because of the lawsuits, but because of the chill factor, the political chill that it puts on decision making, where governments decide what they're going to do based on the fear of being sued rather than on the reality. And so it's a huge drag on climate action, on any kind of measures like that we might want to take.
So there's a question in that raises the your focuses on your criticism of capitalism and economic growth and its and how it's implicated in the multiple crises that we're facing. And so the question really is put to you, are you saying essentially that we need to slay the dragon in order to basically decarbonize as rapidly as we can? Or do you think that there is actually ways we can do it within the system without having to slay the dragon?
Well, I think the dragon ends up dead one way or another. I'd really like to look for a solution that does, where we're actually still around after that happens, the rest of us humans. So, but I think, I'm going to say we need to do everything. We need to do everything we can. We need to mobilize everything we can. We need to work with the tools we have. We need to, there are businesses that are trying to run ethically and, not based on sheer profit, but on making a decent living for the principals and the investors and so on, without just being based on exploitation. We need to work with all of that. I have a lot of sympathy for corporate knights and their sort of green capitalism. I think their heart's in the right place and they need to be challenged to do what they're promising. But at the end of the day, we're one way or another, that is, the dragon is, as I say, the dragon's going to end up dead, and I just don't want us to be underneath it when it falls down.
Okay, so are there examples of national economies that are ahead of Canada with respect to energy, democracy, political,
mm-hmm.
transitions to from fossil fuel to a renewable energy system, where they actually have a more progressive mineral strategy at the same time? Would you point to any particular country as being ahead of Canada in that we could look to for examples of what we could organize around?
Yeah, I mean, I guess the Nordic countries are the obvious example, and part of the problem is that Norway's gone a huge distance to creating a socially sort of responsible system, in terms of social services, in terms of renewable energy use and so on, but they've done it by continuing to pump oil out of the North Sea and to frack in North Dakota. And, they got out of the tar sands investment, but they were there too. And so they're busy building a lovely green caring economy for themselves on the backs of people in North Dakota who no longer have a safe water supply, and everything else that they're doing, just continuing the fossil fuel economy. So that's kind of a difficult one. But I think, if you look at that and you look at the kind of economic mobilization that they've done, that is a model. And we do have a lot of wealth, and we don't really have an excuse for not using it properly.
So are there models of co-op economic development that involves the ownership of mineral resources that could be looked at as a way in which to manage what our mineral needs are going to be, but also to address some of the more egregious parts of their environmental record?
There are not a lot of good examples. I think there are a lot of flawed examples. So, and I think for the most part, what we've got is either public investment that is not using its leverage to any real benefit. So a lot of countries, they'll have a state investment in mining or in oil, but they don't use it to impose conditions on the industry or on the companies that they're involved with. Or you have state-owned companies like Codelco or like there used to be in the Congo, that are not particularly well run and give a bad name to the whole nationalization project, because they don't treat their workers particularly well. They don't they're not particularly caring for the environment, and they're basically treated as a cash cow for the government, because they can produce the profit that would be going to the investors, and that just goes to the state. So yeah, it's not a very encouraging panorama, but I think there is a lot of potential that's unexplored there as well.
Okay, so a final question, and then I think we're going to call it an evening. There's a question about energy co-ops that you made reference to this before, about there being potential for democratic ownership on a much decentralized basis as being a useful thing for us to look at as a way forward. You know, are there examples of community owned, mining operations? Is there examples of other community owned resources that you would point to as a useful way for us to try to advance, the kind of social control that's necessary to rein those industries in and perhaps decommission them when they need to be decommissioned?
Yeah. Short answer, no, unfortunately. There are a few different reasons. One is that it's such a hugely capital intensive industry. And also that it's very unstable. So what you get in mining is a lot of speculative investment, and that's not a good. That's, you don't want community investment going into something that might just collapse. And it's a bit of a vicious circle, because that's also because of the boom bust nature of the global commodities trades and so on, that there's no stabilizing force, so that makes it much more of a speculative investment and less suitable for community investment, but also just because of the scale of it. Like if we're talking about $1 billion project, that's no community fund has come close to that, although governments might. And also, there's a fair bit of engineering involved, as I, started off with. And these are, very technically challenging things, and that also makes it expensive. So there's a bit of an economy of scale that's a problem in that. So there are a limited number of resources that were small scale production actually can be done effectively and responsibly.
I think we're going to have to leave it there. So I want to thank you once again for taking the time to join us tonight and start off our extractive series. I think this is a really good beginning, and I think many of the main questions that we're going to have to address are on the table. And I think you've done a really excellent job of putting those questions in front of us and paying attention to, or trying to find some answers to at least some of the questions that have been posed in chat. So thank you very much for joining us, and thank you for the work that you do. It's been a pleasure to meet you, and I hope we can do this again.
Thanks.